الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله الذي أرسله الله بالحق والهدى بين يدي الساعة بشيرا ونذيرا. أما بعد, my respected brothers and my sisters in Islam, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the Lord of the universe. We say best of our salutations and greetings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the most beloved one to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers, alhamdulillah, we are fortunate this night that we have a guest among us who is a student of knowledge, and mashallah, he studied in front of many great scholars of this time. Our brother, Sheikh Muhammad al-Maliki Hafizahullah, who is a great scholar from Saudi Arabia, he studied with Sheikh Ibn Baz, rahimahullah, and he also studied with Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah. And our brother, mashallah, for the last many years, he has been doing the work of da'wah, and he is not unknown to most of us, because mashallah, he's coming here for the last many years. Our brother, he is khatib and imam in Masjid Bara bin Azib in Jeddah. Bara bin Malik in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. And our brother, mashallah, he is based in Medina. And all the time, mashallah, he is in the circle of scholars, great scholars. And alhamdulillah, we are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that tonight our brother is among us. And inshallah, he will talk about our mother, Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And as I said before in the announcement, that it is a very sensitive issue, because unfortunately, many of our brothers and sisters, they have misunderstandings about this topic, particularly when we are living in the West and people, they are spreading the disinformation about the marriage of our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and they made an issue that this thing happened and that thing happened. So inshallah, our brother, he will clear all these doubts and all this disinformation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him reward for coming here. And now, without any delay and without any taqeer, I will request our respectable brother, Sheikh Muhammad al-Maliki Hafizahullah, faliyatafaddal mashkura.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أتمان الأكملان على محمد رسول الله سيد الأولين والآخرين وإمام الأنبياء والمرسلين والشافع المشفع يوم الدين أرسله ربه على حين فترة من الرسل وانطماس من السبل فبصر به من العمى وهدى به من الضلالة وفتح به قلوبا غلفا وآذانا صما وجعله رحمة للناس كافة وأرسله إلى جميع الثقلين بشيرا ونذيرا وصلى الله على آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وبالأخص منهم من خصهم رسول رب العالمين بمزيد التنويه بالحب والصلة كأمنا الكبرى خديجة رضي الله تعالى عنها، ثم حبيبة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بعدها عائشة الصديقة بنت الصديق، وسائر نساء نبينا أجمعين، وآله الطيبين، وصحابته الغر الميامين، وبالأخص منهم خلفائه الأربعة الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، ومن استنى بسنتهم واهتدى بهديهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، dear brothers and sisters who are listening to us right now, or those who may listen to this talk later on the website or in any other means, I was invited to this mosque, Bakki Mosque in Manchester, United Kingdom, to deliver this talk. And when I was told about the title, my heart was beating so hard. Should I come as fast as I can to defend my mother? Or would I not be so qualified to defend this woman who is the best after the four women that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned? And the hadith, when he said that خير نساء العالمين أربعة, the best of the women of the all universe are four: خديجة بنت خويلد، وفاطمة بنت محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وآسيا بنت عمران، وآسيا ومريم بنت عمران. هؤلاء خير نساء العالمين. These are the best women ever known. آسيا وهي زوجة فرعون، ثم ذكر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الفضل امرأة أخرى، ألا وهي الصديقة بنت الصديق رضي الله تعالى عنهما، وعائشة هي من بيت هو من أفضل بيوتات البشر بعض بيوت الأنبياء. عائشة رضي الله عنها is from the best house of all the houses of men after the houses of the prophets and messengers. And that is because her father is Abu Bakr al-Siddiq رضي الله تعالى عنه, who Allah تعالى mentioned him in the Quran twice. Once in the saying of Allah, ثاني اثنين إذ هما في الغار إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن إن الله معنا. The second of two, meaning Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, The second of two, who said to his companion, meaning who was with him in the cave, don't be sad. Verily Allah is with us. And Allah Ta'ala said about him, as in the other place where Allah Ta'ala mentioned him, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى. All the ulama of tafsir said that this is Abu Bakr Siddiq. The first one who accepted Islam. The one when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken in the journey of Al-Isra, Al-Mi'raj, and returned back, he told the Kuffar of Quraysh that he was taken and one last night to Bayt al-Maqdis, and then he was elevated to the, he was ascended to the heavens, and he returned while they were still sleeping. They laughed and they thought that they have found the chance now to chase people away from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they went first of all to Abu Bakr Siddiq and they said to him, did you hear what your companion said? He asked him, what did he say? They said that he claimed that he was taking a journey in one last night to Bayt al-Maqdis, and then he was ascended to the heavens, and then he returned while we were still sleeping. He, Abu Bakr Siddiq, immediately responded, did he say so? They said, yes. He said, I believe. They said to him, how come you believe? How come you believe like this? He said, I believe him when he brings me the revelation from the heavens to do and not to do. How come I don't believe him when he tells me some information like that? Abu Bakr Siddiq, who when one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged the people to donate fi sabilillah, he came with some money. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, what did you leave for your family? He said, I left Allah and His Messenger. I left nothing for his family. Abu Bakr Siddiq, I'm sorry I said that Allah Ta'ala mentioned him twice in the Quran, but it is three times. The third time is when the incident of evil took place. One relative of Abu Bakr Siddiq called Mislah ibn Uthadin, who Abu Bakr Siddiq used to financially support him because he was poor. He spoke with those who spoke about Aisha. So Abu Bakr as a father was angry. And he said he's not going to give him nothing from now. Allah Ta'ala descended the ayah. وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولِي الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ السَّعَةِ. Let those whom Allah Ta'ala bestowed grace and sustenance on them not to hold their hands for whatsoever reason. And at the end of the ayah, Allah Ta'ala said, أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Don't you like that Allah forgave you? Abu Bakr immediately cried and said, yes, Allah, I like that you forgive me. And he gave Mislah more than what he used to give him before. Abu Bakr Siddiq, the one who, when Rasulullah one day, one morning, said to the Sahaba, من أصبح منكم اليوم صائما؟ قال أبو بكر أنا. Isa Salam asked, who is fasting today? Who become fasting this morning? Abu Bakr Siddiq said, I am also. Prophet Salam asked, من عاد منكم مريضا؟ Whoever of you visited the sick today? Abu Bakr Siddiq said, I did also. Abu Bakr, the Prophet Salam asked, من تبع منكم اليوم جنازة؟ قال أبو بكر أنا. He asked, who of you followed the janaza today? Abu Bakr Siddiq said, I did, Ya Rasulullah. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, never these deeds of righteousness are found in a person except that Allah Ta'ala will let him enter the Jannah from any gate of it that he chooses. And then the Prophet ﷺ looked to Abu Bakr and he said, I wish that you be the one, Abu Bakr. And when the Prophet ﷺ said, I wish, it means that is it. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, when one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on the mountain of Uhud along with Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman, and the mountain shaked. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam held with his leg, with his foot, and said, stable Uhud, stable Uhud, get stable. Only a prophet, a Siddiq, and two martyrs on you. And he said, Siddiq. Abu Bakr Siddiq, whom Rasulullah said, لو كنت متخذا خليلا لاتخذت أبا بكر خليلا ولكن صاحبكم خليل الرحمن. The Prophet said, if I would have taken a khalil is not as translated to you, brothers. All these books of interpretation fail to give you the proper meaning of Khalil. Khalil is not a friend. Cross it. Wherever you see it, just cross it. Khalil is not a friend. Because the friend is in need of his friend, and the other friend is in need of the other friend. Allah is in no need for no one. Even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But everyone, even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is in need for Allah. So Khalil means something more, much, much more than friend. Khalil can only be explained to you, Ikhwan. It cannot be translated. Khalil means the highest rank of love. The highest rank of love. Allah Ta'ala took as a Khalil only two from amongst mankind as we know. Ibrahim alayhi salam and Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So he said, if I would take a Khalil, I would have taken Abu Bakr as a Khalil. But your companion, meaning Rasulullah, is the Khalil of Ar-Rahman. So I cannot have two Khalils. Meaning that I cannot have two Khalils. I have Ar-Rahman. I'm the Khalil of Ar-Rahman. I cannot be a Khalil of any other one. And that shows that the word Khalil does not mean friend. Isn't the Prophet ﷺ a friend of Abu Bakr? Yes. The Prophet was in need one day for Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr is in need also for the Prophet. They both are in need for each other because they are human. Mankind. And that's why he said one day, Rasulullah said, I wasn't benefited with the wealth of nobody but Abu Bakr Siddiq. I wasn't benefited and supported by the money of anybody like it with the money of Abu Bakr Siddiq. Meaning he never hid or held nothing from Rasulullah. Abu Bakr Siddiq, who one day the Prophet was sitting amongst his companions when a poor woman of the Muslims came asking Rasulullah something. He said to her, "I don't have nothing to give you, but come next year," meaning when the zakah is collected. She said, "What if I don't find you," meaning you die. He said, "You come to this man." And he pointed to Abu Bakr Siddiq. Abu Bakr Siddiq, the Ikhwan, is the best after all the prophets and messengers. And he put himself before Rasulullah in all of the dangerous places. And that's why the Prophet married his daughter. The Prophet did not marry Aisha for any kind of enjoyment or entertainment or whatsoever. But he did not find nothing to reward Abu Bakr Siddiq except that they become one family. So that not only in the dunya but even in the akhirah there will be a link between them. That is, daughter be with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why Rasulullah married Aisha. He did not marry her because he wanted to enjoy woman she was only little girl. One may ask, so why did he marry little girl? As I said, Abu Bakr Siddiq did not have any other girl who was free except Aisha. And they, the Sahaba, were competing one another on who can be the one that Rasulullah take his daughter. And that's why we see Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu when his daughter Hafsa was divorced. He went to Abu Bakr Siddiq to ask him to marry his daughter. Because he wanted to have a connection with Abu Bakr, because Abu Bakr is this high level. But Abu Bakr did not show interest in her. Then he went to Uthman. Uthman did not show any interest in her. Then he was sad, he went to complain to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam laughed and told him that Allah will provide her who's better. So he, Umar, knew that maybe those Sahaba knew that he want to marry her. And all of the marriages of Rasulullah, if we just can look, the marriages that he had was not as what people think, that he wanted to enjoy women. One is too old, one is widow with a child, one is this, one is that. He only wanted to bring them all under his coverage. So Aisha radiallahu anha When Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when Khadija رضي الله تعالى عنها passed away, and that was 3 years before the Hijrah, he صلى الله عليه وسلم was sad and stayed widow without marriage until it was 2 years before the Hijrah, when Aisha was only 6 years old. He asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq to marry her. But not to marry her meaning to enjoy her, just to hold her for him, because he was afraid that someone else would come and take her. Then there is no connection that pleased Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, meaning family connection. But the brotherhood in Islam, there is. So he asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And of course, as you all know, that marriages in Islam cannot be until the woman who's proposed agree. So the parents, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Umm Rawman, asked their daughter Aisha, will you accept? Who do you think would say no? Who would you think would say no? That woman who says no must be someone who doesn't know really what it is. So she said yes. One may say, but she's small, she doesn't know. We say okay, but Rasulullah did not enjoy her. It's only a word given. Up until she had the menstruation, and that was 3 years later. 3 years, and Rasulullah waiting. If he would be like what those people say about him, why didn't he enjoy her for the first day? He was waiting for her to be ready as a woman. And that is when the female get the menses. Once the female get menses, then that means she is mature, she is ready for pregnancy, she is ready for marriage. So when Aisha was 9 years old, her mother Umm Rawman came to Abu Bakr and said, ask Rasulullah if you want Aisha to be taken to his house, because she had the menses today. And he took Aisha. What a blessed woman she was. He took Aisha, and look at that. He dealt with her the way she liked. She never complained. And I'm wondering how these people say what they say. She never complained. She never complained of Rasulullah. Never ever she complained against him. He was so kind with her. Whatever, and when the Abyssinians came to Medina and they played, they march in the masjid. He asked her. She did not ask. He asked her, do you want to see? Do you want to watch? She said yes. So he left her over his shoulders. Rasulullah left her over his shoulders. And she was watching. She says that later when he passed away. She said, and he was asking me, is it enough? I say no. He remained standing, and she was standing over his shoulders because she was small. Is it enough? No. Is it enough? No. Until she said yes, and then he put her down. She said when she reported this, she said to the Sahaba or to the Tabi'een, and estimate the young woman interest in entertainment, and she at the same time wants to see her position before Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. How much he loves it. So Aisha radiallahu anha, wasn't forced to marry Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in that age, and she wasn't unhappy. She was one of the most happy women in the world. And that's why even when the incident of suspicion, the evil took place, and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was so sad about that, she Aisha did not take it as a chance to go back home. If she wasn't happy, she would have taken that as an excuse to go. But she was remaining patient. And Aisha, ikhwan, and Aisha, ikhwan, was the most beloved woman to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To limit that one of his wives, when she got old, she said, Ya Rasulullah, do not divorce me, as I want to be your wife in the Jannah. I give my night to Aisha. Why? Because she knew that he loves Aisha. He loves Aisha. The other wives knew that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam loves Aisha, so whenever it is done, because they want to, you know, I don't know what to say in English, but they just want to, yani, because she's the most beloved one, and they are the other wife, jealous, you know, jealousy. So they used to sing whatever they know that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam likes in the night and the day of Aisha. As one day one of them knew that Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam loves honey, so she sent a plate of honey to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When the female slave came with the plate, she said, Ya Rasulullah, this is from your wife so and so. She immediately turned the plate upside down. So the plate fell down and broke, and the honey was there. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam laughed, smiled to the Sahaba, and he said, your mother become jealous. And then he said to her, Aisha, blade for a blade. Now, the blade she broke belongs to whom? His. That is his other house. The blade she is going to give from where? From him. How come this kindness not to be liked by Aisha? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved Aisha so much, and she loved him so much, to the limit that when he was sick, in the sickness that he died with, he asked permission from all the wives, other wives, so that he be nursed in the house of Aisha all the days. She accepted that, and they also accepted that. She was happy for that. that he is staying in her house. Although now he is not staying when he is strong so she can enjoy him, he is sick and she is going to nurse him. But she was happy. And her brother Abdurrahman entered holding a siwak, a toothstick. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at the toothstick and looked at Aisha. She knew that he wanted. So she asked Abdurrahman, and then she found it hard. If she doesn't love him, how would he give it? How would her soften it for him and then give it to him? She chewed it to soften. And then she gave it to him and it became soft. Because she knows that Isa Salim loves the siwak. Aisha radiallahu anha wasn't choosing to be a wife of Rasulullah sallam just before the reasons I told you, that Abu Bakr, etc., etc., but it was because Allah Ta'ala commanded him to marry her. Allah Ta'ala sent angel to the Prophet sallam when he was sleeping for a number of times, holding a piece of cloth, saying, "This is your wife." He sees nothing. Till the third time, he removed the cloth and he saw Aisha. He saw Aisha. Who is saying that now? Aisha. Not any other, but Aisha. What does that mean? That means that she is so happy that she is the wife of Rasulullah. How come anybody come and say nothing, say anything about that now? How come those people speak ill about Rasulullah in this situation? Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha whenever Rasulullah used to go on a journey, he met Mother Chumul of Quran.
Draw.
He make a draw, huh? He make a draw between the wives. And every time, guess what? Every time it is the turn of Aisha. It's from Allah. Because Allah Ta'ala wants him to be most of the time with Aisha. And when they are on the journey, he asks her, "Do you want to race?" So he brings in some entertainment. She says, "Yes." He then stops and tells the army to go far. Until the army is far, then he raises her. And she might, and the first time, she won because she was slim and young and fit. And another journey he asks her. She must have forgotten now the first time. He asks her, "Do you want to race?" She said, "Yes." And then he raised her and he won. And laughed at her and he said, "One for one? Look at that." How come this woman is forced and she doesn't like it? When they used to be sitting on food, on the meal, he waits until she bites from a piece of meat. And then he asks her, "You know, the piece of meat is like this, and you buy from here. Can't you see where it is?" But he wants to drag her attention, that "I love you, see?" He asks, "Show me, where did you bite? She says here, and he bites the same place. And then she may take the cup and drink. Of course, they did not used to have lipstick. So, nobody can show where it is. He asked, show me where did you drink from? Which side? She said this side, and he took it exactly the same side and drinks. So she, none of his wives said that they used to, whenever they enjoy each other and do ghusl janabah, they used to do it together. And not only that, she says that we take the shower from, we wash from the same bucket. I grab some water and he grabs some water and then he says, leave some for me. And I say, leave some for me, and we laugh, joking with each other and playing. See how old is he, and she, how young is she? Like, yani, teenagers married newly. He did not. He's Rasulullah. He's the head now of the Ummah. In Medina became the leader. In Mecca was only Rasulullah, no authority. But in Medina, he's Rasulullah. He is the one of authority. And he is older than her. And his her father respects him highly. Although that, when he was dealing with her, like a young man who married the young woman. Show me where are the young men deal with their wives like this. Show me. Most of the divorce cases today are amongst the new marriage couples, young couples. Because no gentleness, no etiquettes. Look at Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how he does. When they went to the Hajj, she had menses before she reached Mecca. Menses continued with her until the day of Arafah. On the day of An-Nahr, on the 10th, she got free of menses. So now, no way that she can make a Umrah with that Hajj. Finish. When Rasulullah was about to leave Mecca, going back to Medina, she cried and she said, how come everybody go back with Hajj and Umrah and I go back with Hajj? She said, he told her, no, your tawaf you did when you were free of menses for tawaf al-ifadah, that will be enough for them both. So you are qari, you get the reward of both. She said, no, I don't feel happy. He then looked to her brother Abdul Rahman. He said, take her to At-Tal'im. Let her to come with Umrah. The narrator said, as a Sahih Muslim, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, whenever Aisha likes something, he goes to it. Whenever Aisha likes something, he goes to it. So, all this clarifies to us, Ikhwan, that whatsoever statements made about this marriage is only of injustice and oppression, lying, evil. I just want any of them to show me any evidence in the history of Aisha that she was unhappy. I can't show him that she was unhappy. But when Rasulullah ﷺ passed away. When Rasulullah ﷺ passed away, she was unhappy. That is the only time. And guess what, Ikhwan? When Abu Bakr Siddiq passed away in her life, she allowed them to bury him next to his masjid. There was remaining one more space. In her house, she wasn't living in a palace. It was only small house. The first grave, Rasulullah, next Abu Bakr Siddiq. Now, one more left and that's it. She said, I will keep this for me. I want to be by my husband and my dad. But she's more about her husband, Rasulullah. When Umar ibn Khattab was, when Umar ibn Khattab passed away, he sent his son Abdullah to ask her permission to be buried next to the Prophet and Abu Bakr. She said, although I keep this place for me, but no matter what, Umar has more right than me. If she was not happy with Rasulullah, how come, Ya Ikhwan, she did not leave her house even when Rasulullah was buried there? She was sleeping next to a deceased body. She loves him. She loves him in a way that no woman today can love her husband. And when Abu Bakr Siddiq was buried there, she's still living there. She was still living there. Up until Umar ibn Khattab was buried, Umar ibn Khattab is a stranger from her, then she moved. So, Ikhwan, whatsoever statement made against this marriage is only evil. Wallahi is only evil, and I'm very sorry for those who make it. Because they are going to face very terrible day in the day of resurrection. Because they are going to be asked to prove it. How are they going to prove what they say? How are they going to prove the evil that they make? And Allah Ta'ala said about the suspicion made around Aisha that time, تَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. What about the suspicion made around her and Rasulullah too? أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. Subhanallah, this woman was a blessing for many and was a fitna for others. Was blessing for many. We all know the permission of tayammum. Guess what, you guys here in Manchester, in the very cold winter and your burning is off, and now it is Salat al-Fajr. What are you going to do? And you have enjoyed your wife at night. Now, what are you going to do? Take a shower with this frozen water? You die. Aisha was the cause of you to be in ease. As in Sahih Bukhari and in Sahih Muslim. In the journey of Khaybar, when they were coming back, she lost her necklace. And then, this made the Sahaba, the Prophet asked them to go and look for it. Till they had no water. Then Rasulullah, the ayah came to Rasulullah that if they can't find water or only enough to drink, then they can make tayammum. Head on the ground and that's it. Subhanallah. That is all because of Aisha radiallahu anha. And Allah Ta'ala blessed her because Allah Ta'ala could have made this incident to happen with any others. But here Allah Ta'ala made it to happen with Aisha. To show us the merit and virtue of Aisha amongst all. But at the same time, Aisha became a fitna for others. Real fitna. Some talk about her marriage like if she complained. Some others talk about her suspicion, like if they don't believe Allah and they don't trust Rasulullah. Like those Rafida who still until today curse Aisha. A'udhu billah, la'anahum Allah. They curse Aisha to limit that one of their main shayateen of today, who they call him the Imam Akbar in Jahannam, said in a book that he wrote, it's not something we fabricate on him. He said that in a book that he wrote, Al-Wilayat al-Kubra, he said, if we conquer Medina, first thing we do, we dig the grave of Aisha and bring her and make the Hajj, the punishment of fornicating. What did this man believe? Rasulullah is so bad that he accepts to stay with a woman that fornicated? A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. So Aisha, our mother, who we love from the depth of our hearts more than our mothers, I take Allah as a witness, and you all are witnesses on me on the Day of Judgment, that Aisha is more beloved to me than my mother. Because she is the mother of believers. We are believers. Whoever thinks that he is a believer, then he must believe that Aisha is his mother. So we have to respect our mother. We have to show a great respect to all of our mothers, the mothers of believers, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, radiyallahu ta'ala, and especially those whom he sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned with more praise, like Khadija radiyallahu anha, and Aisha radiyallahu anha, and all of them. And never, I don't say never believe, but I say it is haram to listen. Haram to listen, haram to go to the website that talks even about Aisha. Or any of the companions of Rasulullah. Whether those who speak even about Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Aisha and the rest, or those who speak even about Ali, Fatima, Hussein, Hassan, they all are our love. We love them all. We love Abu Bakr, we love Umar, we love Uthman, we love Ali, we love Aisha, we love Fatima, we love Hussein, Hassan, all of them. We love them all. They are the best of this Ummah. However, they are the best of all the nations from Adam to last man after the Prophet Muhammad. So we have here one to pay attention, because some youth are so addicted to the internet, they just go and look. Don't give your heart to others to play with. Keep your heart safe in your chest with the love that it has, with the light. This love you have for Aisha and the light is the light that you can distinguish on this darkness world. This world of darknesses. You can only distinguish by the light of the love of these people. Rasulullah, his companions, his family, these are the candles that we can see our way with. May Allah Ta'ala gather us with them all on the Day of Resurrection. And make us with them all in the paradise, Jannat al-Na'im. And make all of our sins be forgiven because of our love that we have for them. May Allah Ta'ala make one of the major worship that we do, the love towards the Prophet and his wives, his family, his companions. May Allah Ta'ala make it one of the great worship that we get the closeness to Allah Ta'ala through. May Allah Ta'ala bless us and our families by our love to the Prophet and his family and companions. Wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi. We'll leave now the time for the place for the questions, inshallah.
Jazakumullah khair, barakallahu feekum. قبل الله لنا ومنكم، ونسأل الله أن ينفعنا بعلمكم وعملكم إن شاء الله. Brothers, Alhamdulillah, as you know that it was a very informative and very useful talk about our mother Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها and her family. So inshallah, we have the opportunity to take your questions and to get them answered. So inshallah, if you have any question, please write it down, write it down, write it down, and then inshallah you can pass on to us, because we will not take or entertain any questions which are not written. Any questions which are not written, we will not entertain. So please be patient and write your questions, and then inshallah our respectable scholar inshallah will answer your question. Barakallah.
In fact, I'm not a scholar, I'm a brother.
Allah yazeeku khair. Allah yazeeku khair. This is only inkisar and humbleness of our
brother. No, no, this is the fact.
Inshallah, we have a full schedule of our respectable brother in Manchester. You can have a look at the poster on the notice board. And inshallah, on Sunday, we will have another opportunity to get some benefit from the knowledge of our brother, inshallah. And there is a detailed program about all the programs which are going to be held in Masjid al-Sunnah, Masjid al-Furqan, Makki Masjid, inshallah. So inshallah you can have a look at the notice board that when and where next program is going to be held, and inshallah you can get the benefit.
By the way, in regard to the age, the ulama of the scientists of medicine scientists and human scientists, they say that it is different from place to place, climate to climate. And the woman, the girl can be ready for marriage and pregnancy depends on the location where she lives. And here I remember an incident that Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu mentioned when he heard some people wondering how come Aisha were in this age. He said that he knew a grandma who was only 21 years old. 21 years old grandma. Imagine that, 21 years old, and she's already grandma. And he said that when she was 7 years old, she was married because she had the menses, and she got pregnant immediately, and she gave birth of, after 9 months, she gave birth of a daughter. This daughter, again, when she was 7 years old, she was ready to marry because she had the menses. And remember, menses come only from the womb. So, if there is no menses, meaning that the womb cannot have any pregnancy. Cannot have any pregnancy. You can ask doctors, if doctors amongst you. So this woman was 21 years old, she was already grandma, grandmother. This is just to tell those people who say that, how come or how come?
One of our brothers, he asked question, what would you please describe how our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she passed away, because there is some rumor about her death. How did she pass away?
She radiallahu ta'ala anha passed away, first of all, I didn't know what this rumor is, because there are a lot of rumors. I don't know what rumor he's talking about. But she, radiallahu ta'ala anha, passed away in Medina. And here, 54, as I remember, and she was sick for some time, normal sick like anyone, and then she passed away. I don't remember more than that, honestly. I never come across, although that I've read about the biography of Aisha and the history of her, I never come across of these rumors that the brother saying, or any more than what I just said. But what is more important than that is to tell you that Aisha, she was so blessed that with this marriage, that she became very knowledgeable of medicine science. And when her nephew, the lovely Zubair, asked her, "Oh, mom, how come you got this science, knowledge of medicine science?" She said, "Well, when Rasulullah used to be sick, people come and prescribe medicines for him, and I memorize it." And also, she was one of the companions who memorized and reported the most hadith of Rasulullah. She reported 2,286 hadith of Rasulullah. Allah.
Jazakumullah khair. It is another question somebody is asking: during Hajj, can someone make one Umrah going to Masjid Aisha, make ihram and do Umrah as Mother Aisha was allowed to do? Jazakumullah.
If he has the same conditions of Aisha, yes. Meaning, she was in the menses. Could not perform the Umrah of Tamattu. So if this is the case, yes. But other than that, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr, the brother of Aisha, went with her to At-Tarqeen. But he did not bring in Umrah. He did not make in Umrah. You think that he doesn't want, he doesn't love? Of course he loves. Especially if you don't know, if you don't know something I tell you, maybe you saw it. Maybe you say it is difficult for me to go back to Mecca. Let me just tell you: you took only you took only about 6 hours to reach Mecca from Manchester. They took 10 days to reach Mecca from Medina, walking. So it is not something easy for them. Although that he did not make it a chance. Oh, I'm there with my sister at the Tar'im. Let me do Umrah with her. He did not do Umrah. Because yani, that Umrah wasn't part of Hajj. Only because she felt sad that everyone did practically Hajj and Umrah. She did only one ritual, but the ajr, the reward is given for both. So if you have the same case of Aisha, I would say yes. But if you don't have the same case of Aisha, why are you doing it? Taking Aisha as an excuse for doing Umrah after Hajj? No, we'll tell you, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr did not do. Did not do, Allah.
Jazakumullah khair. Another brother is asking, how does a believer react to the accusation towards our Mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha if he's facing with this fitna?
Allah Ta'ala taught us what to do whenever the life of this type of evil is done. You don't stay, you leave the place. As Allah Ta'ala said, لولا إن سمعتمونا في الآية الأخرى فلا يقعد بعد الذكرى. أي نعم لا تخوضوا نعم Now, so يعني as Allah Ta'ala said, you don't sit where it is spoken. And also you don't get to the wounds where they criticize eyes. You don't say, I want to review it, I want to laugh. You don't try to do that. We don't want to waste our time with these people. Leave them, don't get to that. Get yourself busy with what Allah Ta'ala asked you to do. Do your normal duty, your normal worship, and like that. Get yourself involved and busy with what brings you closer to Allah Ta'ala. The reason why I say that is because many brothers say, I'm a Ikhwan, I was in Trinidad and Tobago one time. And one of the brothers who, mashallah, very close to da'wah, always with us, I was shocked. A couple of years later, one of the brothers in Trinidad sent me a link on YouTube for the same brother become Shia. Cursing Abu Bakr, imagine. Why? It is because it's leaking to the websites. I will review them. You have no knowledge, you have no stability. You have no strong iman. And these are shayateen. They act like if they advise you, but they want to put you in the fire. So don't put your heart as a ball in the hands or foot of others. Keep your heart safe and stay away. And let me just tell you two examples of our salaf, the pious brothers and sisters, the scholars, what they do. When Imam Malik, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Imam of Medina, Imam Dar al-Hijra, had a man came to him, man from amongst the people of the nations, asking about the ayah, Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa, ayah sultan. He, Imam Malik, said, al-istiwa'u ma'loom. Istiwa is well known to us. The meaning of it is known. We all know what is the meaning of istiwa. But how it is unknown. Believing in it is obligatory. And then he said, and I only consider you as a person of bid'ah. And then he looked to his companion and said, take him out. They took him, grabbed him, thrown him out in the baqir. The like one of the Sahaba, one of the scholars of the Salaf, Abu Tamim Ayyub Sakhtiani or other, had his son with him when a man of elevation came to him and he said, I want to ask you about an ayah. He put his hand, he put his index fingers into his ears and pushed strong, and he told his son to push strong. And he said, not even half of the ayah. And then he told his son, push strong. I'm afraid that any word of innovation that he says settles in your heart and then you can't take it out. So what we need to do is stay away from all this rubbish. We don't get into what these people saying or doing. Stay away. Go with the salihin. Didn't you hear Allah Ta'ala saying to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاةِ وَالْأَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجَهَ وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. These are the ones you go with. These are the ones you spend your time with. People of righteousness. Not with others. Sometimes a young person becomes so enthusiastic and he wants to go and debate and defend, but they threw some suspicions and he gets confused. Later on he a'udhu billahi rajim. So be careful, akhi. Wallahu a'lam.
JazakumAllah khair. There is another question somebody is asking. Is there a hadith which says that the marriage took place at the age of 16, or is this weak hadith?
No, this is fabricated hadith, not even weak. I don't think there is any hadith like that. Never Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said any limited time or age for marriage. No, he didn't say it. Allah.
Another brother is asking, where did this fitna actually start from? About false allegations about our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and what is the reason behind this propaganda?
This fitna started by the munafiqeen, the hypocrites, during the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we all know what the munafiqeen want. All what they want is to destroy this religion. Then it was propagated by the Rafida, and started with the founder of the Rafida, who was a Jew called Abdullah bin Saba. He's a Jew from Yemen who came to the land of Islam and showed that he is practicing and he is Muslim and he's a good Muslim. And later on, he started doing all these things. He told them that, he convinced them that Ali is the God, Ali is Allah. And then he started speaking evil about Aisha. And later on, they came like that, only to attack Islam. Why? Because Aisha